Drops a bag outside. When we read the fucking mail, it's a hell of a ride. One for my buddy, two for the show, three orange slices and away we go. Listen to mail, come on, listen to mail. Gilbert and Frank's very amazing colossal mailbag. Colossal mailbag. Colossal mailbag.
Hi, I'm Gilbert Gottfried, and this is Gilbert and Frank's Amazing Colossal Obsessions. I'm here with my co-host Frank Santopadre and our engineer Frank Verderosa.
That's a lot of Franks. It's a lot of guineas.
And we'll be talking about Frank Sinatra and Frank Fontaine.
Frankie Avalon, and we already had. We should have had him here.
Frank Ocean.
Avalone.
Now, since we'll be reading some tweets.
Yeah, we haven't heard from our peeps in a while, so we took August off, and the tweets and the Facebook messages are piling up.
I got one from a Vizio boy.
Oh yes,
he
tweets me.
He brought up. See, I think they were more than a one-hit wonder. I think they may have had another hit. I'm not positive.
Okay,
but this was Mouth and McNeil.
Oh, yes.
Yes.
That
I think him and the two of us. And it was, they had a song called How Do You Do?
Yep.
This is it? That's the one.
Yes. What time to love you? I'll remember why. It's true that you can make me cry.
I only know it's long ago.
No,
you said I love you too. But I got one solution, and it's gone to town with you.
How do you do? I thought that we could all la la how do, and then we can la 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 la, and you. And me, and we can go na 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 before, and we can go na 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 na.
Hey, that's what I'm living for.
How do you do? And we can go na 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 na, and you, and we can go na 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 na, and you, and more, and we can both na 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 na.
Why don't we just do a whole episode? Let's just do a whole episode where you sing the hits of Mouth and McNeil. The Mouth and McNeil Lehrer Report. You'd think they had a second hit?
I think they had one second hit that was in England.
Really? Were they British?
No, I think they were actually Dutch.
Wow. Wow. Well, you know, we're only up to 1971 in our recordings.
Maybe they'll pop up.
They might pop up.
Yes.
I guess it's like 70. They've got to be 71 or 72. But they haven't shown up yet, which means they may have been a two-hit.
Yes. Oh, yeah.
Wonder.
But I had to get that one in because sometimes people complain if there's an episode I haven't sung.
We'll get to all of them. You know, people have requested that we do a kind of like a K-Tel record.
Oh,
you remember those with you singing? Jeez, I wonder what the rights issues would be on
something like that. Yeah.
Several generous listeners have written me and said, oh, I know how to do this. I got lawyers in the family and I recordings. I know how we can put this together. We'll do a Gilbert Sings the One Hit. Maybe we can. My future brother-in-law is a musician. He's been saying to me from day one, you guys have to do something on vinyl. So we haven't talked, we haven't heard from our fans and our listeners in quite a while because we took the month of August off.
Oh, yes.
Much needed rest. But so the tweets are piling up, and I thought we'd get to some of them. Here's Armchair Cinema writes, you guys should do a show on Tim Conway movies from the 70s. That guy was everywhere. It's an interesting idea
for
a topic. We really should lean on Tim Conway and get him.
I know,
and get him to do the show.
He's been, but once again, we don't have to rush.
Well, I worked with him at the Mark Twain Prize. He's shy. He's a painfully shy guy. He doesn't give a ton of interviews. But boy, there's a guy that's a gift, and we're lucky to still have him. And
Oh, yeah.
We should make that happen. Jim Reardon writes, I'm having a ball with Cousin Brucey or Real Gilbert and Frank listening to One Hit Wonders on their mini app at work, not working. People are loving those mini. Those One Hit Wonders. So we will keep them coming, and keeps Gilbert awake.
Yes, and plus, you know, my people. You know, my real talent is singing.
you're the victim moan of comedy. Ron Gardner writes, Jonathan Katz, episode 117, was the first one I listened to twice on back-to-back days. Epic. Boy, we had fun with Jonathan Katz.
Yes, yeah.
He is out of his mind.
I remember at the very end, I just completely lost it.
Yeah, that's for our engineer Frankie is very fond of that episode. And I will admit we've sat in Nutmeg listening to playing back the last 10 minutes of that episode repeatedly.
And I remember what was making me laugh. It's not how funny it was, but how unfunny.
Yeah.
It was like he'd come in with these stories yeah. that would go absolutely nowhere.
That's part of his charm.
Yes.
That's part of his
and
brand.
So when he would start in at the end, I would lose it. I was already gone.
Yeah. it was a different episode. It was the rare guest who brought his own production.
Oh yes,
but he we didn't have to work that hard.
That was a wild one.
He is just a gem. We love Jonathan. He's a treasure, and we'll have him back one day. James Spencer, I laughed loudly at the Jugal reference. appreciate that. I made a joke about trying to find out who's Jewish and who's not Jewish. I said Jugal it. Put it in Jugal. That's nice that people recognize the jokes. A lot of tweets about Marvin after we lost.
Yes,
we lost the great Marvin Kaplan, who we did an episode about.
Yeah, he was a treat,
an absolute treat. We did a tribute episode about him. That's already posted by this point. Lots of people wrote us about Marvin, and that was touching. A lot of people wrote and said, thank you for getting his stories out there, and thank you for making me aware of him. And I knew he was that guy on Alice, but I didn't know, or I saw him in It's a Mad, Mad World, but I didn't know he had this big career, and I didn't...
And once again, much younger people would say, I didn't know who that was, but I really liked him.
It's so gratifying. Keddie Ogilati.
Say that three times.
Yeah, I'm watching Titanic. Can you guys book David Warner, please? There's an interesting actor.
Oh, yeah.
David Warner. And one of my favorites, time after time, is Jack.
Oh, that's right. With Malcolm McDowell and...
Yeah.
What's her name?
Mary Steenburgen, his ex-wife. But he turns up in Time Bandits and a million other movies. And The Omen.
Oh, yes.
The original Omen with Gregory Peck. He's decapitated. We could try him. I don't think we've had a British guest.
No.
I mean, a lot of dream guests like Richard Lester and Malcolm McDowell, but we haven't closed on any of those yet. We'll try.
Now, was Richard Lester English?
I misspoke there. He was born here.
Ah,
he's an expat.
Ah, okay.
But I think of him as a Brit.
Well, it's kind of like, what's his name, the animator?
Terry Gilliam.
Not him. He was American,
born in
of
Minnesota,
course.
Yeah.
But, this is what kills me when it's somebody that I know Jason and the Argonauts.
Ray Harryhausen.
Ray Harryhausen.
Yes.
You tend to think of as a Brit, but also born in America.
I don't think I knew that.
Yeah.
Yeah, interesting. Michael Anthony, thanks for the Matthew Broderick episode. You mentioned Nathan Lane. Brilliant idea. What do you think? Nathan Lane would be wonderful.
And I remember a few people commented how I didn't wait 15 – how I opened the episode with Matthew
yes!
Broderick by
there was
telling
a lot of
him
that.
that I fucking hated –
You're a man with balls of brass, my friend.
What was the name of that movie?
Ferris Bueller.
Yeah, that I started off by saying I fucking hated Ferris Bueller.
But he was a sport. I'm looking at the chair now in the studio that Matthew was sitting in, and I'm thinking, well, he was really kind.
He really was.
About that.
And what was really nice about it, at the time he did that, he had a play to do that evening.
Yeah, he was doing a play at the Irish Rep downtown.
And he rushed over here, did the interview, and then rushed out to do the play.
Only to get insulted.
Yeah, only so I could say the truth. I fucking hated
Ferris Bueller. That's why I kept trying to get to how much we loved Election to mitigate.
Yeah, I started naming all the movies of his I hated.
Yeah.
I think he's a fine actor.
Yeah, he's been in some bad ones that weren't his fault.
Yeah, well, that Godzilla one was horrible.
You brought
horrible.
Up Godzilla? Well, you opened by insulting him about Ferris Bueller, and you closed...
with Godzilla.
With the other knife in his ribs.
But he was very nice.
He's a sport.
And he is a fine actor.
He's a terrific actor. And he can do drama and he can do comedy. And he walked out of here reeling. It's like, why does Gilbert hate me? Dave Hasselbeck.
So I guess we'll never have Sarah Jessica Parker.
Well, never say never.
I'll
My
say,
friend.
I fucking hated Sex in the City. What a piece of
But she's
shit.
Done some good work,
okay.
too.
She has.
Yeah.
She really has.
David Hasselbeck says, I can't wait for Gilbert's version of Billy Swan's I Can Help. That should be a classic.
Oh, it would sure do me good.
Yes.
To do you good, let me help.
I know that one. I used to think that was Ringo when I was a kid.
It sounded like.
At least sounded like Ringo.
When Ringo started doing all those country western things.
He did a few.
Yeah.
Billy Swan is 1974. We haven't gotten there yet.
No.
We're only on 71. So it'll take a couple of weeks. Lots of people writing about those One Hit Wonder episodes. People really eating them up.
Because people love good music and good singers.
And what you've done. Lisa Vickery writes, Africa Screams was really funny. With Abbott and Costello, there's no way you can go wrong. You like that one?
Yeah.
You like Africa Screams?
I still have to stick, though, with Abbott and Costello Meet Frankenstein.
It's the best one. It's the best one by far. Somebody says, Shane Simon sent us some Twilight Zone toys. William Shatner, I guess it's the monster on the, I always forget the name of that episode.
The airplane.
The monster on the wing.
I remember the one I liked better than that was the William Shatner where they're stuck in a town.
Oh, with a little fortune teller on the table. That's a creepy one.
Really? That's a scary one.
William Shatner was in town, I might add. He just hosted our friend Bob Lampel's show, Gotham Live downtown, and we let him slip through our fingers, but we'll get him back. One Hit Wonders, didn't Elvis cover Polk Salad Annie, which I mistakenly referred to as Pork Salad Annie? I guess I was hungry. Anthony Tritolo.
Or you were horny.
Maybe, one or the other. Anthony Tritolo. Maybe he did. We have to look that up. this may be my favorite tweet in months, and it doesn't make any sense, and I adore this. Benderoni. He tweets a lot. Do either of you fellas care to guess the bite radius of Martha Ray?
Yes. That...
Is that a Jaws reference? What's it? Because she did denture commercials?
Yeah. This was no boating accident.
But she did commercials.
She did.
For Polygrip or something.
Oh, yeah. Take it from the big mouth.
That's where he's going. That's where he's going. Lion Adam. Holy cow, I had no idea Anatomy of a Murder was such a great movie with a great cast. Pretty sure I see Floyd the Barber.
Oh, my God. He could have been.
Does he turn up in Anatomy of a Murder?
He could be.
Remember your Floyd the Barber, Bob Dylan bit?
Oh, yes. I'll have to do that when I have more time.
We'll bring it back.
Now, and, let's see. What were we? Oh, also, if anyone can find me a copy of a Pontiac.
Uh-oh.
Commercial. There was a Pontiac commercial that I remember that had Lon Chaney Jr., Broderick Crawford.
Are you kidding?
And Elijah Cook Jr.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
I have never seen that.
Yeah. I would love to see that one again.
Doesn't Elisha Cook Jr. or somebody show up? Do you remember when Lucille Ball did the Skittle Bowl commercials? When she was Fast Lucy? It was a Hustler parody. Was it Sheldon Leonard or Elisha Cook or some famous mug shows up?
I remember.
Maybe it was Len Lesser.
Elisha Cook Jr. shows up in an episode of The Odd Couple.
Yes. Like, as Wilmer the Gunsel.
Oh, yes.
Yes. Yeah, it's the flashback episode where Felix's,
a very
Felix's
funny
grand,
one.
Felix's father is the optometrist.
Yes.
Yeah, and he sees something he shouldn't see, and the mob has to bump him off, and they send Elisha Cook. Oh, that is great stuff. I can't even say this person's name because it's sort of just a collection of letters, but Bike Burr, B-R-H, tweets, the Pipkins' Gimme That Ding, which we talked about
on
One Hit Wonder, was part of a soundtrack to a British cartoon called Oliver in the Overworld.
Huh.
Tony Burrows, by the way, is the guy behind the Pipkins' Gimme That Ding, and also several other songs that we talked about on the show, like Love Grows Where My Rosemary Goes.
Oh, wow.
And we got to get Tony Burrows on the show. He's on the short list.
Cause love grows where my rosemary goes, and nobody knows
Edison
like me.
Also, United We Stand, Divided
by
Brotherhood of Man was also Tony Burrows. He's kind of a genius in his way. We have to find Tony Burrows. Frank, besides any Groucho books you'd recommend, besides Groucho and Me? Any Groucho books?
I don't know. There's so many.
You like? I love this. Joe Dutra writes Rondo Hatton in Jungle Captive.
Oh, that was just on recently.
Oh, my God, what an awful film.
I think it was done, the makeup was done by Jack Pierce.
Really?
So it was just a repeat of the Wolfman makeup, but on a girl. And Rondo Hatton, he used to talk like that.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, poor guy.
Yeah.
He writes, he adds, acromegaly is no prize. For people who thought it was an advantage in life.
Yeah, and it's like Rondo Hatton, it looked like his career was going to take off with these kind of parts. And then after a while, I think everybody after a while was just getting creeped out.
By the creeper.
But yeah.
Appropriately
saying
enough.
Saying that it's just wrong.
Yeah.
But then there was that other deformed guy, Michael Berryman.
Oh, the Hills Have Eyes guy?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And he had some kind of disorder.
Yeah.
And he was making money off that.
Yeah.
Is he still around?
He's got to be. We can try him.
Oh, Michael
Berryman.
Be a good one.
We're after Sid Haig, too.
Sid Haig.
We've had requests for him, but I got contact info for him.
Oh, and you know why we have to get Sid Haig?
Why?
Sounds like a Jew.
Just maybe. Bill Davis writes us to say, tell Gil that Clint Walker is still alive. Well, these are the kind of things I say when I run into you in the morning. Did you know Clint Walker is still alive? He was in both The Dirty Dozen and The Finks.
Oh, my God.
We got to get him.
A fine film.
The Finks was run recently.
Yes.
I think TCM or somebody pulled it out.
Yeah, Turner Classic Movies.
What was that about? Them running that, pulling that thing out of mothballs.
It was so weird. It was like a bad version of the Monkees, if such a thing is possible.
Lewis Lepton writes, another fantastic podcast with Hank Garrett, one of the best. We loved Hank.
I was surprised by the amount of tweets that Hank Garrett
wrote. He brought it.
He really did.
He's got all the stories. He's got the Al Lewis story. What was the one, Frank, about Al Lewis stealing the food in the deli?
I just love that. That's okay. I like a giveaway of my food.
Right. I love that. Posing as a cop because they were dressed in the Car 54 costume.
Merry Christmas, officers. Merry Christmas.
I love a giveaway of my food.
And wasn't he the one who also had the story of getting knocked out by O.J. Simpson?
Yeah, smashing his head into the car hood. He had great stories.
And then after he's waking up from being unconscious by being knocked out by O.J. Who knew O.J. Simpson could be violent?
Exactly.
And he's waking up. His wife shows up right as Sophia Loren is cradling him in her arms.
Well, he suggested that it led to the dissolution of his marriage.
Yes. And then he said, after he finally got back together with his wife and apologized over and over, they were walking through Rome, and he hears from across the street Sophia Loren go, Hank!
That's great.
And throws her arms and hugs and kisses
him. Great.
And that finished his marriage altogether.
Hank's one of those guys who just had a fascinating... And how about the fact that he wrestled with Luca Brasi?
Oh, yes.
With Lenny Montana.
Yeah.
And all that stuff about the farm boy, the Minnesota farm boy.
And then
Wonderful stuff.
Who has stories about Car 54.
Yeah, we will.
I love Car
54. You were eating that up with a spoon.
Yes.
Anything to do with Car 54.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I love that show.
He had BS Pulley stories. He had stories about Nipsey Russell. I loved your Nipsey Russell story, by the way. I played that one several times over. Big Daddy writes...
Now, is there a big rush to get Nipsey Russell, Joey Ross, or Fred Gwynn? Or can we still wait?
We can move. I can give that one a little time. We got a lot of tweets when Gene Wilder passed. Big Daddy writes, "We could all use a blue blanket right now," and sends a meme. That's sweet. We got a lot of those. We did a Gene Wilder episode that I'm sure you guys have already heard. Peter Stoffers writes, "You'll love this one, Gil. Esther Williams' husband was the alleged crossdresser Jeff Chandler. I can't believe Gilbert didn't know that."
I had heard this.
Yeah.
Yes. I had heard that.
Because you asked who was married to Esther Williams.
Yes.
And we said it was Fernando Lamas later.
Yeah. Oh, later on.
Later.
Yeah. The original one was, what's his name again? You just said his name.
Jeff Chandler.
Jeff Chandler. Now, Jeff Chandler, I also think... is the one who turned Sammy Davis to Judaism.
That's the story. Was it Jeff Chandler?
Was it Jeff Chandler?
Or Jeffrey Hunter?
I'm wondering about that.
Oh, geez.
Which one's a Jew?
I don't know.
Because Jeffrey Hunter, I think, played Christ, didn't he?
Yes. Yeah, I think in King of Kings, or was that Max von Sydow? No, Max von Sydow wasn't the greatest story ever told. I think King of Kings.
How do we look this up?
Well, we need Paul Rayburn, who's not here.
Yes.
I'm looking it up now.
Okay.
All right. Continuing, and then you can interrupt me, Frankie. Dick Meldrum, Esquire. I love this. I love this tweet. "I'd hate to see Rhonda Hatton." That's a great tweet.
There was also a guy who looked like he may have been a little deformed, but I'm not sure. And there was this actor, I don't know if he's still alive, named Irwin Keyes.
I know the name, Irwin Keyes, yeah. I don't know.
He always played, like, dumb gangsters in, like, sitcoms.
Okay. How was he deformed, dare I ask? I'm already regretting the question.
He had two holes in his penis.
Really?
Yeah.
You just pick him up like a bowling ball.
So, did you find out anything?
What do you got on Jeff Chandler Davis Jr.? You are the worst Paul Rayburn impersonator.
Okay, I know,
here's a story.
Okay,
I heard when Jeff Chandler was married to Esther Williams.
Uh-oh.
And I don't care if it's true or not, because if it's good enough.
When has that ever stopped
it's
you?
It's fucking true.
Uh-huh.
I heard that she said, well, if you're gay, then how do you make love to me? And he said to her, I just imagine two beautiful women making love together. And I think that's when she pretty much called an end to it.
Wow.
Yeah.
Where do you pick up this stuff?
Yeah. at the fruit stand that used to sell orange wedges to Cesar Romero.
Really? I'm hanging around the wrong places.
He's still alive, that fruit stand owner.
Is that the same guy Al Lewis ripped off?
I heard, too.
Yeah.
Someone told me. Now, this is the first I've heard of it.
We should have changed this show to I Heard.
I Heard. That
or Someone Told Me.
Someone told me that aside from Cesar Romero, that there's something having to do with citrus fruits and Raymond Burr.
You don't say.
Yeah.
Who is this someone that told you?
I don't.
You don't want to. You don't
probably
wanna.
The same fruit stand.
You shouldn't reveal their identity. There isn't enough time left in either of our lifespans to cover Raymond Burr.
And
citrus fruit.
We'll have to devote a whole episode to Charles Lawton.
Yeah,
with the shit sourdough sandwich.
RJ tweets.
Okay.
You mentioned Krabby.
Hey, you're interrupting.
I'm just hoping that we can pass it by and okay. no one will know what
well,
you just said.
That's how they made the Charles Lawton sandwiches, by passing it by.
All right. I've just got a few tweets left. Okay. RJ writes, you mentioned Krabby Appleton on a one-hit wonder ep. They appeared on John Biner's show.
Oh,
there's a thing.
Now, what did they?
I can't remember what their song was.
Oh, shit.
Go Back? Go Back, I think, was Krabby Appleton. Your friend Video Boy, or Video... Boy? Or
Vidzio.
Vidzio Boy. One of my fave songs is Hamilton, Joe, Frank, and Reynolds. Don't pull your love out on me, baby.
Don't pull your love out on me, baby, honey. If you do, I think you're maybe crazy.
Something
and
like
I
that.
Just lay me down and die for 100 years.
I love that song. I guess they weren't a one-hit wonder. It says from 1971. We somehow miss them.
And the music used to be... Dun, da, da, da.
Oh, it's got a great brass section. I love that song. Yeah. I love that song. I love the shit out of it. Three Oranges writes. I wonder if that was always his Twitter handle or if he's just a,
somehow.
He's just a hardcore fan.
I think I may have had an influence.
Maybe he likes still life paintings. Did you ever consider that? He might love Matisse. He writes, I love that you ask people about Phil Leeds.
Oh, that's right.
His appearances on Nightcore. We had an entire conversation about Phil Leeds with Steve Weber.
Yes.
Running.
And he was on Ally McBeal, too, as the judge. And in Ghost.
Yes, he was. And yes. He was Hank Kingsley's agent on the Larry Sanders show. Eddie Haskell writes, I thoroughly enjoyed your interview with Hank Garrett Greenberg. As usual, yours and Gil's knowledge of showbiz never fails to amaze. It's a sickness. And I like Eddie Haskell's second tweet. Frank, he didn't send this to you, he just sent it to me. Do you think Gil may be a Rain Man? I'm not going to comment.
Hey, guys, I'm sorry to interrupt, but Wapner's on in 5 minutes.
5 minutes to Wapner.
Of course, I'm an excellent driver.
You do have an uncanny ability. I've never seen it. I've never seen you respond to a box of matches dropped on the floor, but you have certain abilities.
Oh, yes.
You have certain talents.
Yes. And I'm stupid in all other areas.
So you can't balance a checkbook.
Yeah.
But you could tell me everything about George Zucko's military service.
Yeah. I'm incompetent for everything else. But ask me about Angelo Stevens.
Or Stella Stevens.
Oh, yes.
And this is how we'll wrap.
Now, will Stella Stevens do our show?
Well, you asked her early on.
I don't think she...
I just want to talk about the Poseidon Adventure for hours.
Oh, her in her underwear.
Yeah.
That.
We'll end with this. Christopher Puncher.
Which was another thing that Cesar Romero was in.
I didn't realize Puncher. That.
Yes.
This is a favorite tweet. Frank... You had me at So You Were Luca Brasi's Tag Team Wrestling Partner. Yeah, the amazing Hank Garrett. So, and one
that
last...
was such a surprise favorite.
Yeah,
I loved doing this show. We both got a kick out of talking to him.
He was great.
But I had no idea the audience would love it as much as they did.
And one last bonus one from Joe B. McMahon. Thank you for the Sonny Fox interview. I've listened twice, and it's your best work.
The Sonny Fox one.
Yeah, that was special.
That one, I thought, you know, sometimes we'll do an interview and we'll start talking, okay, you know, we might have to shorten this part or cut out that part when we get. With the Sonny Fox, I thought from beginning to end, everything was amazing.
You know, it's funny you mention that because I wonder what people's attention spans are.
You know,
some podcasts are 2 hours, some are 30 minutes. I mean, we've had people say make them shorter. We've had people say make them much longer. Everybody has an opinion. I sat down to edit that Sonny Fox episode and I thought, I can trim a little here.
Yeah.
I can trim a little here. It was so riveting. All of it was so good, especially when he teared up. He's talking about being the camp being liberated. I couldn't cut it. And it wasn't even just out of respect for Sonny, but because it was so damn good.
And I remember
so absorbing.
Right afterwards, like we always have that talk, like, oh, this part could be short and that part. And there I remember thinking, I can't think of any part I want cut.
Almost no edits. I maybe one in the Hank Garrett episode. It was flawless. It was just like you would design it if I could design it from start to finish.
And with the Sonny Fox, being held captive by the Nazis.
Yeah.
And, and that part where the sergeant said to the Nazi.
The Spartacus moment.
Yeah. He said, all of us are Jews here.
All in the game show scandal stuff, too.
Amazing.
He just had gold. He was an eyewitness to great stuff.
Yeah. And a great story. He called up Dara, and he said, when are they going to run my episode?
Oh, yeah.
And she said, in a few months. He goes, run it quicker than that. I'm in my 90s.
I'm 91. Yeah. We moved Sonny up in the queue.
Yes, I figure. Can't argue that one.
He had a point.
But he was great.
The best, and a real gentleman. And I'm sorry we didn't. He was in New York, and the scheduling didn't work out. We were going to do it with him live. We wound up doing it on Skype, but we didn't get to meet him.
Yeah.
But that was a treat.
But no rush. We could always talk.
No rush, as you love to say.
Okay. All right. This has been Gilbert and Frank's Amazing Colossal Obsessions.
Any Mouth and McNeil to take us out with, Frankie? You still got it?
Let me cue it up.
Mouth and McNeil.
Once I said I love you, I don't remember why. I don't wonder if it's true that you can make me cry. And now it's not so long ago that I love you too. Constitution, I start anew. How do you do? And you can say hello on you. And you and we can do na-na-na-na
just like
before. And then we can na-na-na-na. And you and we can do na-na-na-na. And you and me and they do you do. Aha! And we can wait. Na-na-na. And everyone can na-na-na. Hey, everyone, and you, and me, and na na na, and that's what I'm living with.
Listen, a man.